Welcome, everyone. We'll start in 1 minute. In the meantime, you can put where you come from in the chat so we can see the diversity of the participants today.
Hi, Andrea. So hello, everybody. I suppose our time is ready to start. Welcome, everybody, to today's Kids and Cities webinar on behalf of the Placemaking Europe Kids Working Group. My name is Maja Simoniti, and I'm coming from Institute for Spatial Policies in Ljubljana, Slovenia. And here with me, there are my colleagues, Goitske from Goitz in Zwille, Netherlands, Viviana and Julia from Hausi Pichanga, also from Netherlands, and Maciej from Skawina in Poland, and Beata from Warszawa in Poland. So here we are, six of us. We met through the Placemaking Europe Network, which connects thousands of placemakers from Europe and abroad. And we have last seen each other alive last year at Placemaking Week in Valencia, Spain. Most of us this year, like many others, and most of you, I suppose, we spend this time at home behind the computers. And we also met with the computers or with computers. Ever since the pandemic started in March 2020, except for a short break in the summer, we have met once a week to discuss the situation of children during the coronavirus disease and, of course, our situation. In the fall, we decided we wanted to do something new. We wanted a project, something to work together, more serious than just a regular weekly talk. And so this led to an idea that we wish to gather the placemaking community around the children and participation of children in placemaking on a session, on a seminar. And this led us to where we are today, to this seminar and this unique group of guests you're going to be listening to together with us, and whom I also warmly welcome at this moment. And we are very sorry that we can't be together alive, because we are very well aware that it's much nicer to be together alive. But anyhow, we are happy to be here together and to celebrate World Children's Day with optimism and good spirit. Today, the world celebrates World Children's Day. What does this mean? Simply said, it means that the adults, those who has the decision-making power, need to be reminded at least once a year that there are also children among us too, and that they have special needs and that they have their rights too. For example, the right to participate in the matters concerning their lives. And there is placemaking where participation is like all the whole part of it. And of course, the placemaking community is very sensitive to the participants. So it's obvious it's supposed to be also sensitive to the children as participants. And here we come to our meeting today. And I'm really very happy that you join us in such a great number and really eager to listen to our guests. So, Vivi, the floor is yours. Tell us how the program is going to work for us. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Maja. We're Super excited to have everybody here. Just a few reminders before we start with our amazing diversity of panelists that we have today. One is that the meeting is being recorded because we're going to publish it later in our webpage for other people to also see what is going on today. So if you wouldn't like to be part of the recording, please just switch your video off. Another thing that we would like to tell you is that we will have a question and answer session at the end of the presentations, but you can put your questions in the chat at any time. We will, depending on the number of questions that we have, we'll try to answer them all today. But of course, if we still have questions pending, we will add them to the Facebook group that we will invite you at the end. So everything will be answered, if not within the meeting, a little bit later, but we want this to be a great community in which we can discuss in any moment. So thank you everyone for coming, and I'm very happy to introduce you first to a great panelist today. We are having a child, of course. It is very important for us to really bring their voices to the table. That's what we work in every day, right? So we're having today an interview that we're going to show you with Dominic. He is the child mayor of the city of Amsterdam in the Netherlands. He is 9 years old and he's in the class 7 in primary school. He was born in Amsterdam and lives there with his parents, his 8-year-old brother and 4-year-old sister. He says he loves to read in his spare time, especially Harry Potter books or books by Miriam Mouse and Caris Lee. And he also loves to play Lego and Monopoly, which is his favorite game. On October 23rd of this year, so very recently, he was elected as the new children's mayor of Amsterdam. And together with the Children's Council, they hope to represent all children of the city. So I'll share with you this great interview performed by Goitske to Dominic, and I hope you enjoy it.
Welkom allemaal bij het interview. Als eerste wil ik graag zeggen dat ik namens ons hele team van Placemaking Europe Kids spreek. Dat we het een eer vinden om jou, Dominique, te mogen interviewen voor ons webinar Kids and Cities op vrijdag 20 november. Omdat je er niet bij kunt zijn, moeten we het helaas opnemen. Ik had het heel leuk gevonden als je er ook bij zou kunnen zijn. Maar goed,
ja,
jij wordt 16 november geïnstalleerd, of geïnaugureerd, heet dat met een mooi woord. En ook jouw moeder zit naast jou. Zou je het misschien even kort voor kunnen stellen?
Nou, ik ben... Oh, wie moet eerst? Ik ben Jennifer van Halen, de moeder van Dominic, de tweede kinderburgemeester van Amsterdam.
Ja.
Super trots. En we gaan een heel spannend en leerzaam jaar tegemoet, denk ik. We proberen hem zo goed mogelijk te ondersteunen.
Hartstikke mooi. Ja. Heel goed, dank je wel.
En ik ben Dominic, ik ben 9 jaar oud en ik ben verkozen tot kinderburgemeester. Ik zit in groep 7 en ik heb een broertje en een zusje. Mijn hobby's zijn lezen en af en toe game ik ook.
Dat is natuurlijk ook heel leuk. Dankjewel Dominic. Wij gaan zo meteen een aantal vragen bespreken. Maar ik wil ook even Hasna UT het woord geven. Waarom ben jij hierbij betrokken, Hasna?
Nou, Hasna Yutai en ik ben van de gemeente Amsterdam. En samen met een collega trek ik de kinderraad en de kinderburgemeester. Dat is vorig jaar voor het eerst van start gegeven. Meningen van kinderen die tellen mee en wij nemen dat ook heel serieus. En zodoende hebben wij ook een paar keer in het jaar, 6 keer in het jaar kinderraadsvergaderingen. Waarbij de kinderraad adviezen uitbrengt aan het college. Die worden dan ook serieus overwogen om te kijken van, kunnen wij dit uitvoeren? En zo in het kort. Dus daar hou ik mij mee bezig binnen de gemeente, onder andere.
Goed, dankjewel. Hartstikke leuk dat je er ook even bij bent. Het is bijzonder, vind ik, dat een kinderburgemeester geïnstalleerd wordt. En wij zijn erg blij om dit op te kunnen nemen en wat meer te horen van waarom het zo belangrijk is volgens Dominique dat deze rol bestaat. En daar ga ik wat vragen over stellen. Dus als je het goed vindt, Hasna en Jennifer, dan is Dominique nu even in de hoofdrol. En dat is ook de rode draad.
Dominique,
zoals het hoort, ja. Dominique, kun je misschien je ketting even laten zien?
Ja, het is niet zozeer een ketting, maar een keten.
Een keten. En die keten, wat is het? Kan je een beetje omhoog houden?
Nou, dit is heel Amsterdam. En de losse onderdelen, dat zijn de verschillende stadsdelen. Zoals dit is Noord.
Ja.
Dit is Nieuw-West. Dit is Oost. En dan nog de andere stadsdelen, die zitten hier ook tussen.
En waar woon jij ook alweer?
Ik woon in Nieuw-West.
Nieuw-West, jee. Goed. Nou, dan wou ik nou met de vragen beginnen. Sowieso hebben we het net al een beetje over jezelf gehad. Maar wat doe je bijvoorbeeld in je vrije tijd?
In mijn vrije tijd? Nou, ik speel heel veel buiten. Ik hou heel veel van lezen. Koken vind ik ook heel leuk.
Koken? En wat maak je dan zoal?
Salades, wraps, van alles. Van alles een beetje.
Wauw, wat goed, hé. En heb je ook dingen waar jij je echt druk over maakt? Want het is niet voor niets natuurlijk dat jij de kinderburgemeester bent geworden van Amsterdam. Kun je daar iets over vertellen?
Ja, ik zou willen dat discriminatie en pesterijen en racisme zoveel mogelijk tegenhouden, wil ik heel graag. Ik zou ook willen dat er meer activiteiten zijn die toegankelijk zijn voor iedereen. Zoals als je niet genoeg geld hebt om op vakantie een leuke activiteit te doen. Dat je dan toch nog iets leuks kan doen.
Oké, mooi. En zou jij vanuit jouw rol als burgemeester wat willen vertellen waarom het belangrijk is om naar kinderen te luisteren?
Nou, kinderen die zijn heel belangrijk voor de stad, omdat ze helemaal geen problemen zien. En als ze geen problemen zien, dan kunnen ze de volwassenen helpen, omdat als kinderen bijvoorbeeld een nieuw gebouw moeten bouwen, dan denken ze aan heel veel waar de volwassenen niet aan denken, omdat ze alleen maar aan tijd en geld denken.
Wat goed. En denk je dan ook aan een bepaald punt? Waar denken kinderen bijvoorbeeld aan, wat je net zei, dat volwassenen daar niet aan denken?
Bijvoorbeeld als je een speeltuin moet bouwen en als de volwassenen dat alleen doen, dan denken ze waarschijnlijk alleen aan de veiligheid, maar niet aan hoe leuk het is. En als kinderen erbij helpen, dan kunnen ze aan beide dingen denken.
Wat goed, ja. Dat snap ik wel. Ja, want wij denken, als een kind valt, doet hij zich dan ook zeer, terwijl het eigenlijk niet altijd per se erg is, toch?
Klopt.
Ja, oké, goed zo. En als jij nou morgen iets zou mogen veranderen, hè? In jouw leefomgeving, in jouw directe omgeving waar je woont of waar je bijvoorbeeld naar school gaat. Wat zou je dan in je stad veranderen en waarom?
Ik zou willen dat er meer speeltuinen komen die voor alle leeftijden interessant zijn.
Dus ook voor mij?
Nou, ik weet niet of je naar de speeltuin gaat, maar als je naartoe gaat, ja, dan wel.
Oké, en heb je dan ook een idee hoe dat er dan uitziet misschien? Kunnen we misschien, als ik niet wil spelen, misschien wat anders doen? Of,
zover ben ik nog niet.
Zover ben je nog niet. Het is eerst even een soort hersenspinsel, zoals wij dat dan zeggen. Hè? Ja, oké. En zijn er nog andere dingen waarvan je zegt, die zou ik willen veranderen? Je noemde net al, nou, dat je je in wil zetten voor, hè, in je rol als burgemeester. Voor racisme en pesterijtjes en zo. Mag ik vragen, is dat ook omdat je zelf daarmee te maken hebt gehad?
Ik heb niet zelf gepest, maar soms, toen ik een keertje over de straat liep, toen zei iemand, gaat terug naar je eigen land. En dat kwetsen me wel heel erg.
Dat zou kunnen, dat kan ik me heel goed voorstellen. Het is ook niet aardig. Dan kwets je mensen als je dat soort dingen zegt. Dus daarom heb je hem ook echt hoog op je lijstje staan.
Ja.
Ja, en doe jij al wel iets in je eigen leefomgeving om het leuker te maken bijvoorbeeld?
Nee, nog niet, maar daar ga ik wel heel veel aan doen.
Ja, nou dat staat hoog op je lijstje, dus dat kan niet missen, hè? En, ja. En wat en wie heb je daar dan voor nodig? Want je kan het niet alleen natuurlijk, hè?
Nou, voor die speeltuin heb ik misschien een kinderadviesteam nodig dat zich bezighoudt met alle speeltoestellen. En het moet ook uit verschillende leeftijden bestaan, zodat er niet alleen een wip en een schommel komen, maar ook dingen die interessant zijn voor oudere kinderen.
Juist, dus dat je met elkaar kan spelen. Dat is ook wat je graag wilt, hoor ik wel in al, ja. In al je dingen.
En misschien ook een sport- en speladviseur die alle sport- en speltoestellen regelt.
Kijk, en daar heb je natuurlijk Hasna weer voor nodig die jou daarbij helpt. En je kinderraad natuurlijk, ja. Goh, wat goed, hé. En heb je daar ook geld voor nodig? Krijgen jullie ook geld als kinderraad en kinderburgemeester?
Nee.
Amsterdam?
Nee. Maar ik ben al lang blij dat ik kinderburgemeester ben, dus geld hoeft niet.
Nee, geld hoeft niet. Nee, dat snap ik. Hey, en als je, er luisteren hier heel veel mensen naar. Ik ga het ook helemaal vertalen in het Engels en zo. De ondertiteling, dat wordt nog wel een dingetje, want we praten lekker veel. Maar als je nou de volwassen mensen, hè, als je die nou een boodschap mee wil geven. Over het gesprek wat zo meteen plaats gaat vinden. Hè, want dit is het eerste ding, het eerste filmpje wat we laten zien voordat wij starten. Omdat jij voor ons bent het kind wat belangrijk is in dit verhaal, omdat jij op een hele andere manier kijkt. Dat heb je zelf ook al net aangegeven. Wat zou jij dan iets tegen ons willen zeggen? Waar moeten we op letten als we een stad willen ontwerpen door de ogen van kinderen? Of waar moeten we op letten als we samenwerken met kinderen? Wil je misschien nu je tot ons richten? Dat je echt even gaat zitten en even een statement kan maken aan deze volwassen mensen die zo meteen meeluisteren.
Ik zou zeggen, als je samenwerkt met kinderen, neemt ze dan heel serieus. Hoe belachelijk hun idee ook klinkt, je moet ze gewoon heel serieus nemen, want kinderen hebben goede ideeën.
Precies. En wil je nog iets anders meegeven? Waar moeten we aan denken als we samenwerken?
Nou, dat... Ja.
Moeten we veel limonade meenemen bijvoorbeeld? Of moeten we zorgen dat kinderen ook... laten we zeggen.
Nou, ik zou zeggen, laat de kinderen op hun gemak voelen, zodat ze ook beter gaan nadenken.
Oké, en wat zou dat daarbij helpen? Voor jou bijvoorbeeld? Wanneer voel jij je graag op je gemak?
Als ik bijvoorbeeld met vertrouwbare personen in een kamer zit.
Ja.
Als ik die personen ook ken. Als het gewoon lekker knus is om te zitten. Dan voel ik me heel fijn.
Mooi. Wat gaaf. Ja, ik weet niet. Zou je nog iets anders willen vertellen wat ik je niet gevraagd heb?
Nee.
Oké. Okay. Nou, mag ik jullie bedanken? Wil je nog even zullen we nog even zwaaien? Mag ik nog even een fotootje maken? Dan moet Jennifer er natuurlijk ook even bij. Wacht even. Ontzettend bedankt.
Ja, jij Dominique, ook bedankt.
Dominique, veel plezier aankomende maandag met de inauguratie.
Oké. Okay. Thank you very much. I really hope you enjoyed this great interview that we made. I'm just going to ask you for a second to close my YouTube because now I have some other videos that nobody wants to see. And we continue. We would love to know if you also within your cities also you have a children's mayor. If you would like this idea, so please let us know also in the chat. We will be super happy to know who and what cities also have children's mayor. Maybe we can put them in contact. Maybe we can think about how to work with them. And yes, it would be amazing to create also this network of children that are leading in their cities for their rights and for important problems, as Dominic just mentioned. So after this, I would like to welcome Adriana. Oh, I'm sorry, not Adriana. Inés van der Voet. She's also from Zwolle. And she's a communications consultant in the educational field. And she's also a mother of a 5-year-old child that has an autism spectrum. She will present the parents' perspective, which is, of course, super important to understand how caregivers are feeling and parents are feeling and what are their challenges as well. Her child, Victor, he's 6 years old. And, well, she will present this perspective and speak as an advocate for neurospatial children who have difficulties in expressing their own needs, but who can have a different experience in the public space that we should take into account. Welcome, Inés. I give you the floor.
Well, thank you. And thank you also for inviting me and being able to express the voice of my son, who is in fact non-verbal. He cannot speak for himself, but he has a lot of interest. He loves to go outside, yet there are many challenges. And before I start talking about challenges and possible solutions for those challenges, I would like to introduce him with a short video, which I will share with you. Can you all see this?
Yes. Inés, I think the music is not—it's not on. If you would like to share it again, or
we've had that before. One moment.
Yes. If you share it again and tick on share computer sound, and then it should work.
How we start.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
And now I'm gonna try to get back to. So that was the introduction. I hope everybody got a chance to see it and to hear it. As was told earlier, he is now 6 years old, almost 7 years. And he has a form of autism, which means that he is unable to talk, and that he is very sensitive to certain sensory experiences like sounds and lights, and that he also has special interest for other sensory inputs. So he loves to feel the earth, and he loves to feel water and to walk uphill and downhill. And this has to do with issues that all people with autism have in a more or less severe way, I must say, but they all have it in some way. And that is that they have an impaired sensory processing. They have mostly have limited interest and repetitive behaviors, and they have difficulty in social communication and interaction. So what does this mean for the public space? It means that going outside with a child that has processing troubles for sound, that the world can be a very scary place. That when you are unable to filter important sounds from not relevant sounds, that it can be very chaotic. And it also means that, the playgrounds sometimes do not offer the stuff that you like as a child. So as we could all see, you really like to get muddy and wet and have some real physical challenges. So there's also some design challenges here if you want to include these children completely. And I think the last thing is, of course, the social part. And that is the part that means that he cannot reach out himself to other children. So he's actually very dependent, and I think a lot of children on the spectrum are very dependent on others to reach out to them. So how can you make that happen? I mean, there are initiatives that playgrounds on schools, they now have some kind of color system that a child can say, I'm open to play, or I want to play and I don't know how. I mean, those kind of ideas, really, I can really relate to that for the public space. Also, for a child, for example, for an adult also on the spectrum, he can get overwhelmed. And then when a person is overwhelmed, they get out of touch of themselves and out of touch of the environment. So they can also become a scary person to approach. So how can you tackle that problem? By offering quiet places, for example, or by offering quiet moments or quiet activities. And I mean quiet, I mean no music in the shops, for example, during 1 hour a week, or maybe experimenting with other kind of sounds on certain moments or on certain events, so that they can participate in all kinds of activities. And so that you can approach, you can do experience with white noise, you can experience with natural noises, you can experiment with safe places where somebody can find refuge in a busy place, or maybe you can create a place that someone can stand in order to be invited, or maybe turn it all around. Maybe you can create a playground for children with special needs that all the other children come to intentionally, and then they know that they are gonna play with all kinds of kids. So the special needs kid is always the strange kid in the playground, because he is the only one. So you could also switch that by creating places where special needs kids can play and come together, and where everybody knows that this is such a place where all kinds of people can come. So you may not be watched, you know, you may get bullied less, let's say that, yeah. And what's another thing? I was triggered by the child major who said, well, should adults also have a playground? And then he said, no, maybe not. Well, maybe when you take a real inclusive look at this topic, then adults may need a playground, especially special needs adults, because these sensory processing issues are a lifetime problem. And most adults really would love to sit on a swing for an hour a day, because it tempers, it eases them. But when an adult autist would enter the playground and do that, that would cause some eyebrows to raise, I think. So that is also something that just came into my mind when I heard him speak before. So to me as a mother, I think it is very important that my child can be in the open world as much as possible, because raising him in a really protected environment is important sometimes to learn him cope with things. But then you also have to find the environment to learn him interact with challenges. And well, that is sometimes difficult because the challenges are too big in many parts of the city right now. So if we can find some balance in that, that would be great.
Thank you so much, Ines. Really, it's very nice to hear this perspective that normally is not on the table, and we definitely have to change this as soon as possible. We would like to open questions now for you, because we know that you have to leave a little bit early. So if it's okay, I will tell you a couple of questions that are on the chat.
Yes, okay.
Sure. So Yanglin is asking, what do we have to provide for the caregivers of children who are in special, in public places, playgrounds? Sorry, I should repeat it. What do we have to provide for caregivers of children who are special in public spaces and playgrounds?
Well, that's something I've been thinking about a lot. For example, one of the things we, as a parent of Victor, who looks very normal, I always struggle with the dilemma, am I going to tell people about, you know, his limitations or not? When someone has Down syndrome, you come in and you can just, everybody knows that it's going to be a little different when he wants to play. So what can we provide for? I wonder how to make clear to the surroundings that, well, some behavior is not due to lack of education or due to lack of parenting, but you know, the real understanding, that's actually the thing you need the most. So I've been thinking, do you have to, for example, make him wear something to show the people that he is different? Is that some kind of way to go, or would it be another place where you can sit just to show that you have difficulties to initiate contact? Such kind of things. I don't really have a direct solution for the playground, I must say, except for designing playgrounds that offer sensory challenges also. So not only the swing and the climbing things, but also the places where you can get really muddy, really watery, and where you can experience the earth and the elements more. I think that is, most playgrounds are indeed a little too safe, a little too thought out. They may be a little bit more natural. Yeah.
Yeah, indeed. Yes. Thank you so much for sharing. I also have another question. I see that there are other questions on the chat, but as I said, like, we will gather it and share it with you so that we can share with everybody after the webinar as well. I personally also feel very familiarized with this. My nephew also is in the autism spectrum. And I see that, for instance, his parents struggled a lot at the beginning to learn, because this is a learning process that probably it's a little bit more specific, you know, to go through. So who do you think, or where did you find some support for this learning process? Are you expecting it from schools, from the city, from the government, from other parents? Who would you think that has to join, you know, this process in order to support each other and to raise these voices?
Yes, all of them. So school, when luckily the diagnosis for autism is set at an early age nowadays. So around 2 years, 3 years, you already can have the diagnosis. So at that moment, the child is not yet in school, but there are many early intervention teams in cities that are multidisciplinary, that will help you find the right place to go with your child. But it's all very orientated on going to school and cognitive development, and not really the social development. So that part is something that you have to do yourself. And I think that, well, in right now, it has been a real long search for me, actually. So right now, only 3 years, 3 years after 3 years searching, I discovered that we have something called the disabled child in Holland, which is really active to in initiatives for inclusion. So they have a community of children in all the Netherlands. That can join, and then it's called playground gang. And then when you join that community, you actually you join a community of inclusion. So they initiate all kind of playground hours where they say, okay, in Zwolle, that playground, children with and without disabilities come together and they play together. So they all make a real conscious decision, also the parents, and that's important, that the parents actually, from the neurotypical children, actually encourage their children to go out and play with other children, because it also makes them grow. It makes them grow. Children have the natural habit to help other children and to guide them through any kind of situation. And that is something that would be missed out of if you don't create these kind of communities. So making communities of children and parents is the first step to really socially integrate, I think. And in this case, there has been a stichting, hoe zeg je dat? It's been a non-governmental organization who is actually initiating this. But it is, I think, paid for also partly by the government. So what does this kind of thing need? It needs a lot of promotion. And awareness has to be raised, because I really think that most people don't have any idea what it means to have a neurospecial child. And why We come from a place where children like this would be in a special institution, kept calm all day, and stay in their own world. So we are really growing as a society also into this. Eh? So I'm very aware of that, and there's just a lot of work to do on both sides, both on the parents with neurotypical children as the parents with neurospecial children. We just have to dare to open up a little bit about the challenges they face, because it's also very vulnerable to do that.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ines, for sharing, and definitely a call of action, I think, for everybody also to take this into account and to start joining this movement. No? Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
I'm very happy to have you today. So we're going now to our next speaker, Adriana Relika. She's from Slovenia. She's a sociologist, a human rights and sustainable development enthusiast with a background in international relations. She will talk today about the gaps and the bottlenecks in ensuring the full implementation of children's rights, including, of course, the right of participation and the open question about which issues do children and young people consider as key importance. And for instance, how will the EU level developments, such as the strategy on children's rights and child warranty, will further improve the situation of children in Europe? Welcome, Adriana. The floor is yours.
Hello, and thank you, of course, to the organizers for this invitation and also for this very inspiring start of the debate. It was, I think, also very powerful and inspiring for all of us to listen to the very important messages about accessibility, about inclusivity, and about participation. And in general, of course, I'm very happy that we are discussing this important topic of participation of children on the World Children's Day. If we want to make the world more friendly to children, of course, it's the issue to be discussing. Maybe some background. I come from a legal NGO which works on migration, on human rights and environment protection, and I'm responsible for children's rights. And I've been focusing on unaccompanied children, but nevertheless, I will try to contribute to this debate on various aspects on children's perspective that we've encountered along our activities and maybe might be of interest to this audience. I would like to start off that we often hear, especially by decision makers, that children are our future, but most of all, they're also our present, and that's why it's very important to include them to any decisions that affect them, which Maya already mentioned in the beginning. The right to participation is outlined in the Convention on the Rights of the Children, which is the most widely ratified international treaty on human rights. But we still see that there are quite some gaps and bottlenecks in how this right is implemented. And of course, it is also questionable how the opinion of children are given due weight, of course, in line with their age and maturity. I will be focusing on national context because that's where I have most information of. And in general, Slovenia ranks quite high in various child rights indexes. Nevertheless, despite the fact that children's rights should be among top priorities of any government for that matter or any institution, the strategic document on children's rights has been adopted only this year, while the previous one expired in 2016. And that Slovenia should strengthen its the right to participation of children was also recommended by the Committee of the Rights of the Child in its last concluding observations from 2013. And there are a few mechanisms established on national level for children's participation. We have heard a child mayor from Amsterdam, and we have some municipal children's council established in Slovenia. The network of UNICEF Child Friendly Cities is coordinated by UNICEF. And then the Friends of the Youth Association implements Children's Parliament Initiative, which is another initiative enabling children to voice their concerns. Then maybe on European level within Eurochild, which is the European network on children's rights, they established a Eurochild's Children's Council, which guides the operation of the network and ensures that children's views are heard in activities of the network. And we currently have a representative there. When preparing for this event, I was thinking what would be maybe interesting to hear on child participation and messages of children and youth that we heard through various activities. And last year, we implemented a World Cafe in collaboration with UNICEF Slovenia, with Friends of the Youth Association, Slovenian Red Cross, and other partner organizations. To enable children and young people to inform the process of drafting the strategic document on children's rights. And for example, in the field of education, children and young people recommended developing a subject for life, which would cover more flexible, practical curriculum, which would be skills-based and skills-oriented, and it would educate pupils and students on various topics and skills important also for later for independent life. They also emphasize the interdependence and effects of poverty on mental health, meaning that stress within the family stemming from poverty or weaker social and economic situation of a family also negatively affects the mental health of children. And in terms of participation, children often do not feel included in decisions related to their health. For example, doctors tend to talk to parents instead of talking to children when children have health problems. They also stated that children from economically or socially disadvantaged backgrounds should be ensured free of charge leisure time activities, which is also emphasized by the child mayor from Amsterdam. And then if I continue, this year we implemented focus groups, again with collaboration with UNICEF and an NGO network SLOGA, to provide children's view in the process of developing the EU strategy on children's rights. And if I focus on their views on local communities and housing, green areas in the neighborhood where they live are important for participating children and young people in those focus groups. And then across different focus groups, children report they feel safe in their environment, which is certainly a very good message. But then, of course, they also mentioned public transportation and as something important in their neighborhood. But then if we focus on the right to participation, they often feel that their opinion is not given due weight or that they are not taken seriously enough, which has already been one of the messages by the child mayor. And that even adults tend to be somewhat patronizing toward them. Then maybe if I just add, because being related to the previous presentation, I mean speaker, Ines, it was similar messages were conveyed by children from institutions, that even within the social protection system or school environment, they tend to be labeled, for example, as problematic, and adults don't understand that the family circumstances is not their characteristic, it's just one of the factors in their lives, which they try to try to mitigate, but it's not their personal characteristics. In general, what young people and children also often pinpoint is the importance of digital security, especially since the social media channels are often and widely used. And of course, then related to that is so digital security, online violence abuses, and of course, then the questions about reliable information, disinformation, and hate speech. So this is all from my side. I look forward to the discussions, and maybe I'll share some links in the chat. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Adriana. I think it's really interesting to know about children's rights and how this has been from the high level trickling down to what we can do every day. And I think it's very important to emphasize how children would feel familiar in their neighborhoods. So maybe from placemakers, how this is the scale in which we should be intervening, of course. and about children's participation, of course, not only to listen to them, but actually take them seriously and understand that the conversation should be from both sides, very serious and taken into account. So thank you so much. It was very, very interesting and nice to have you here. And if you have questions, don't forget to put it in the chat. And at the end, we'll open a Q&A session for everybody. As for our next speaker, we're very happy to welcome Roel Camps. He is from the city of Antwerp in Belgium. He's an expert on participation and inclusion of youngsters, a main developer of a new policy for participation, advises councils for citizens of the city and its 9 districts in Antwerp. And he sees his work as a social contribution because he ensures that children and young people who do not have the right to vote now can and may give their opinion about the city they live in. He describes his function as a great balance between working at a strategic level and in field work. Welcome, Roel, the floor is yours.
Hello, everybody. Hello, everybody. I'm Roel Camps from Antwerp. Hold on. Here we go. So how do you ensure that the voices of children and young people are included in a structural manner, and how does this work practical? This was my first assignment when I started working for the youth department of the city of Antwerp back in 2011. After two years of research and trial and error, we developed in 2013 a modern contemporary policy based on an old phenomenon called whistle of crowd. Hang on, something, there we go. On a strategic level, the policy states that every citizen of the city of Antwerp may express his or her opinion in a way that is open, highly accessible, permanent, transparent, physical or digital. And we call this a political framework. We also have a framework for civil servants of our city. And this framework states that all civil servants work for our customer, the civilians. We must be cost consciousness in everything we do. We must work together, have integrity, and have an eye for diversity. The policy exists on 3 equal pillars of participation. And the first pillar means that the city of Antwerp organizes open participation for all citizens. And this is initiated top-down with the intention that all citizens may and can give their opinion. The bottom-up part means that the city will always consider with every bottom-up signal, can we support or even organize this? And of course, we as a city will always try to ensure the participation of our youth when something is about to change. Now, in an ideal world, is this combination already a very wide and open policy for participation? But we're not living in an ideal world. So what if a political decision stops the administration from doing this? And therefore, we have the youth councils. And these youth councils were created by the city to ensure the participation and involvement of children and young people in the city. And the city can ask for advice, and they can and may advise the city at any time on their own initiative. In an ideal world, this would be great. But what if the councillors in those youth councils are only interested in their own youth associations? And can and may we expect that young people in these advisory boards skip school to consult other young people in school? And the third pillar consists of all partners who receive a funding agreement from the city. And the city can ask for advice from them, and they can give advice on their own initiative at any time. But they don't have to question youngsters, because those people are youth work professionals, such as youth workers, coordinators, and directors of youth work organizations. And in reality, we see all the three pillars working together complementary, and we support these councils on a financial, methodological, and process level. And the three pillars of participation are based on the main condition that every Antwerp citizen has access to something open, accessible, permanent, and transparent as an advice platform. This is the abstract level, and this is a frame that we can use for several years. But how do we do this now in real life? We have 130,000 youngsters living in Antwerp. They are our customer. So we had to find a way to reach as many youngsters as we could with minimum staff and cost. So we made a connection between the Antwerp policy and the Antwerp values. And we developed 10 rules to ensure that combination between the policy and the values in a sustainable way. The first rule is find out in advance which space for change there is. Because if there is no space for change, then it's not a participation about including opinions. It's just a fun workshop. Determine the shape and the format of the desired result. How will you analyze given or opinions or given photos? Find out where the target groups are. You won't reach them with social media. Where are they in real life? Provide clear, intelligible content and assignment for the user. Make sure that an 8-year-old understands it, because then you know that every adult and teenager and youngster will understand it too. The eyes want something. We can work easily accessible by using images and video, and we will also prevent image confusion. Choose a suitable approach for methodology, timing, and the processing of results. Is this kind of methodology fit for this kind of project? Can we test it? Is there enough time to carry out and for processing? With free time, yes, we can advance. Perform this methodology with various target groups at different locations. Don't expect civilians to come to you. Take your tool, the participation tools, and go to them where they are in real life, in schools, youth associations, and various places in the public domain. Provide the concept of the participation project in a fair way. And everybody has an own individual opinion. It's normal that different people have different opinions. So make sure that everybody can give her or his opinion. And it's up to us to use all those given opinions as an inspiration for further development of the project and explain what will happen to the opinions and explain how the feedback will take place. When you have completed these 10 rules, you are sure that the wisdom of crowd shall work. So instead of thinking about how one magical tool or methodology can ensure the inclusion of and participation of children, teenagers, and youngsters, we have searched a solution to reach as many as we could. And with these 10 conditions, we can always deliver customized solutions depending on the nature of our project. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's very nice to see these 10 rules that we can really follow and maybe take, like, you know, like print it everywhere we work. And it'll be amazing, like, really, to if you could share this with everybody. I think it's very important what you said, that we should go beyond the social media to find the target groups, like actually act in the field ground. Even when these are top-down initiatives, it's always important to go there, to talk to children, to respect everybody's opinions, and of course identify where is the space for change where we can actually create an impact. So
yes,
thank you very much. Please, no, to everybody, keep asking your questions. We will answer at the end. And thank you once again. So we are going now for our next speaker. We would like to welcome Bas Barmerdam. He is a founder of Consulting Kids in Den Haag, the Netherlands. So I'll tell you a little bit about Consulting Kids and their work. You know that children's worldview is totally different from ours as adults. So their views of the world are with an open mind, and they can ask questions that sometimes adults no longer dare to ask, or they come to ideas that we don't no longer think about. So consulting kids harnesses the children's way of thinking and their lack of inhibition, and inspired by their refreshing ideas, they uncover innovative solutions that help organizations to overcome their challenges and keep them moving forward. The issues are very different, and they range from business strategy to organizational development, or even reducing poverty, or talk about governance for regional cooperation between decentralized youth care organizations, for example. So definitely know the typical children's topics. Consulting Kids provides children with day activities, and so it's a day in which they can let their imagination run, and then they could learn also how to solve problems. In this way, the teacher learn about problem-solving skills, and adults get ideas that they could develop with children in their own organizations. So we'd love to hear more about this. Bas, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you, Viviani. that was basically my presentation. So if there are any questions, then no, just kidding. Hello, my name is Bas. As Viviani just mentioned, I'm calling in from our office in the Netherlands at the moment, and I'll just try to switch to the presentation I prepared for you guys. Okay, can everybody see this? Viviana, can you see it? Yeah, okay. Then I know you guys can watch it. Just 30 seconds on my background. I've got a degree in biopharmaceutical sciences, which has got something to do with medicine development. And I started my career off as a strategy consultant, which basically means I was hired by organizations. They had a problem, and I just sort of pretended I knew how to solve it, which was pretty fun, actually. So it was all over the place and long hours, but a lot of fun. Two things. I wanted to start something off on my own, to start my own business. And at the same time, I got into contact, or at least got the notion about the fact that kids have a different perspective. And I wanted to make consultancy a bit more fun. So that was an important feature. And that's the basis for the company we have now for 6 years, which is called Consulting Kids. And in essence, as Viviana mentioned, is what we do. We provide refreshing solutions for all kinds of complex issues. Could be organizational, could be social, but we do that based on the ideas of kids. And if I talk about kids, it's the age range of 8 to 12. That's what we primarily work with. We do some things on the side, but that's about 90-95% of our business. I just want to run you through the way we work so you get a grasp of how we approach it. And I want to share two cool outcomes just to show you to what kind of solutions you can end up with. And after that, looking forward to discussing things on questions you have. So the first step that we take is we start off in a setting like this. So most of the times we have these gray guys in suits looking very seriously. And at the same time, we do address the sort of critical issues within an organization. So our starting point is adults in a meeting room or whatever. And our starting question is, what are your top 3 or 5 issues you run into? And just to give you an example, we did issues around how do you keep the healthcare system accessible and affordable? How do you solve a privacy paradox? How do you increase learning within a situation of a multinational? So something which happens in country A doesn't happen in country B. Any issue is possible. So the real question is, what are your top 3 issues? And we can do something with that, no matter the complexity. And then the second step is once we understand what it's about as adults, how do you say that, within adults, then we translate it to something that kids can also relate to and so that kids can understand. And the way we do that is we translate it into some sort of fairy tale, a short story into a imaginary world. We use these figures, which are presented here. In the Netherlands, they have a Dutch name called Gompies. And we build a story around that these guys, and they experience all sort of things. And the reasons why we do it is, one, it makes it more fun for kids. Two, you can control the context because the information you provide in the story is the story. And the third thing is, it makes it easier to explain it to kids, but at the same time, because it's imaginary, it even broadens their minds way more. Because if you ask what can be doing in your street, they're limited to the street, but if you draw an imaginary street, then something else is also possible. So then our third step is we take over classrooms for a project, and we tell them that story that we've written, and after that I also explain to them, if I'm in the classroom myself, you know, I'm this really boring 44-year-old guy. I don't have the imagination anymore you guys have, but we have a real issue that we need to solve. Can you help us? And then the only reason why I'm telling it as a story is because I like it that way. And that's a starting point. And then after I raise the question, they start working on it. They do that individually in small groups. We support them with that, not providing them with answers, but providing them with additional information at their request. We also have our clients in the classroom, so they can ask questions to them as well. And besides that, we do that in the Netherlands. We also work in Uganda, Nigeria, the UK, India, and that's it. That sounds big. But we cover most from the Netherlands, but we have people in Uganda and Nigeria. And the other side is, as I mentioned in the beginning, I mentioned something about my degree, but after that I did a lot of those way too expensive educations as well. And I still like to read those management books. And it's not rocket science, but there are some cool things in there. And looking back, I'm 44 years old now. I would have liked to have known a lot of the skills I'm using at the moment. I'd like to have known them way earlier, and their skills related to problem solving. And what we do in a classroom is we teach them or get them experience, give them experience with these problem solving skills. But instead of doing that on something which is not real, we do that on a real life case. So it works. It works both ways. After a session with the kids, they're all promoted to junior consultants. They get a degree / certificate for that. So we have a couple of thousand of them running around, mostly in the Netherlands, but also in other places. And this is what you get out of one classroom. It's unbelievable, the amount of ideas, and plus drawings and structures and anything like that. This is from one class, and you get ideas which are spot on, things we don't understand, things which are not related to the question at all. It goes in every direction, but that's fine. That's no problem. And what we do after that is we translate it back to the adult world again. So for us, critical in our approach is we start off in the adult real context. Then we translate to something that kids can relate to, and the ideas of the kids we translate back again into the adult context, so that the outcome can also be utilized within that adult context. One of the end products could look like this, not to show you the details, but just to show you the structure. Here in the center, you see a question from a multinational about learning in the context of a multinational. Surrounding that, you see a short script of the story we told the kids. And that fully filled line, fully filled circle, are all the quotes. And in this case, we work with kids in the Netherlands, in India, and UK. So we color coded them as well. And then we clustered all the ideas of the kids just to get a sense of what types of knobs they're turning on to get onto ideas. And the outer ring are the translations back to the adult world again. And the way it works is you just take a couple of the quotes, you play with them. Maybe you add something from yourself, maybe you add another quote from a kid, and you start playing with them so you can get to concepts which actually make sense again. They're all based on the ideas of kids, but sometimes it's 90%, sometimes it's 70%, that varies. Just to give you two examples, I added two simple and nice ones, which still fit in the time to explain them to you guys. The question which was raised to us is, in the Netherlands, they want to build a new highway. And the people who live in that area, they're going to be working there for, let's say, 3, 4, 5 years to make it happen. And the question was, how can we inform the people within that area so they know what's going on and what's going to happen? And when we talked to kids, one of the guys, a 9-year-old guy, mentioned, okay, if that's the question, you have to start a zoo. And for me, that was brilliant, because if somebody gives you advice to start a zoo, normally in a normal setting, you would chuck that away, because it's not realistic. But if you take that advice and you have to force it into an advice, this is what we came up with. So just imagine you have that crane in the center and you add eyes and ears to it. So you change the crane into a giraffe. You have all the other cars there. You put eyes and ears to it, and that way you change all the machinery into animals. And you basically are creating a machinery zoo. You put a fence around it, which you have to do anyway for the safety. And you put speakers to make music and sound. And you let them produce animal sounds. And in this case, in this way, you created a machinery zoo. And personally, I have two kids who are 8 and 10 years old. And if this was close to me, I would really like to go to watch this. And that's exactly what you want. Because if you go to this specific machinery zoo, you see what's going on. It's attractive, it's fun, and you can create information around it to explain what's happening. Another short example is we worked for the Dutch Railway Organization in and they had to buy a lot of new trains for a lot of money. And they asked us, how can we change the update the interior of a train in a way that people in 30 years' time would still like to go by train? And what happened was a couple of kids raised two really cool facts. And the first one was, in a train, there are a lot of people, which makes sense, but you sort of forget that. And the other thing was, if there are a lot of people, there are probably also a lot of smart people in a train. And if you think about that, it's really cool. In a train, you have a lot of thinking power, which is unutilized. So how cool is it if you can utilize the thinking power within a train to solve issues? So how cool would it be if you sit in a train and you can post your question? People can see it on a screen in the train and you can respond to it or walk over. So if I post it and I'm saying I'm in chair 40, you can walk over to chair 40 and get a discussion going on. It's not intervening, so if you want to look outside or read a book, no problem. But in this way, you're creating sort of a crowd thinking. And I like what Rule mentioned is wisdom of the crowds. This is wisdom of the crowds within public transport. And this is the way it works. So you get these notions from kids. My personal experience is that they don't provide full-blown solutions. So you have to play with them and you have to combine a lot of them and you have to flip them 180 degrees and paint them yellow and then flip them again and see what happens. And then you get really cool ideas. 1 minute. So after that, we present all the ideas back to the client. We let them pick which ones they're actually going to implement. And then they're off. So they initiate action. They have to go back to the class and present back what they're going to do and why they're going to do it. And that's it. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Bas. Well, I hope I presented so well that I get hired then, because this is my dream job. I would love to work with kids to find solutions for all this range of problems that are out there. And I think it's super important and that we know also the amount of solutions we can get from them and how simple they can be. So yes, to everybody again, to please put your questions for Bas in the chat, and we hope also to have some more discussion at the end. And now we're going to our next speaker. I would like to welcome Beata Patunishka. I know I've said every name wrong, but with this I have excelled for sure. So I apologize in advance. I actually practiced, but it went wrong. But stopping that, we are going to present her. And well, Beata, she's also part of the Placemaking Kids group, and we follow very much her amazing job with kids. She's based in Poland, and for over 15 years now, she has been involved in the property sector as a public relations and also marketing advisor. And she is connecting the role of a property advisor and a mother. So in this way, she started investigating children's experiences in the city. She believes that children are important participants of urban space, and therefore they should be included in deciding about its shape. She also believes that truly smart solutions are simple and that we don't need to employ state-of-the-art technology. Very often, children are the first ones to spot these simple solutions. So that's why she talks and listens to children, speaking on their experience of the urban space, and she shares her findings normally during conferences, writing articles, and educating. Recently, she has been preparing a children's book that we really hope to see out soon, which is aimed at talking about children's experiences about their first independent travels in the city. So welcome, Beata, and maybe you can say your last name right. And the floor is yours.
But let me first share the screen. And this is it. So, yes, my name is Beata Patuszyńska. I'm based in Warsaw, Poland, as you said. And I investigate pleasures and barriers that children encounter while starting their urban independence. And today I'd like to tell you why, after talking for 2 years to adults during placemaking conferences, I decided to write a book for and with children. But first, if we talk of listening to children, let me give the floor to Hugo, the narrator of my book. He will introduce you to the main characters and the idea of the book. Hi, I'm Hugo. I will tell you of my urban adventures, what I like and dislike in the city. I'm 7 years old, and next year I'll be able to go to school on my own. For the time being, my mom takes me there. Usually my older sister Jana goes with us. I remember once I went to school without an adult under Jana's supervision because my mom didn't feel well. The last minute I was hoping that I would meet my friend from school and his mom on the tram stop. Then the trip wouldn't be so totally mommyless. That's my sister Jana. She's 10. For 2 years, she has been traveling to school on her own, but she doesn't like it as she gets bored. She knows the way to school very well, and she knows what to do. However, she doesn't always know how to deal with new situations. If something new happens, she always talks about it with her mom on return home. They discuss what she should have done. Usually mom supports her idea. Sometimes she suggests something easier that Jana could do next. And this is Beata, our mom. We call her Mimi. She deals with the city, how it is arranged and why children don't always feel well there. She talks a lot to children, to me, Jana, our friends and other children I don't know. She can see that adults don't listen enough to children, so she tells them about our opinion. She wishes children are happy in the city. Every day on our way to school, Mimi, Jana, and I play urban games together. Other people, street lights, trams, or little stones on the ground are all part of that game. Some help us and some prevent us from winning points. Unfortunately, rules in that game are decided by adults, and we don't always like to follow them. So we find our own rules and ways to enjoy ourselves in the city. And now it's back to me. I'm writing this book for and with children. They're my models, my teachers, my reviewers. And the characters from the book are based on me and my kids. Stories and like hacks that can be can make traveling easier. Comments that I include in the book I know from real children and to whom I talk during my research and my workshop. I also check every chapter with them. To see if they understand and like what I write. And when I finish the book, I plan to do a workshop to find out kids' reactions, comments, and see if anything needs changing or adding. My interest in children and cities started for my daughter. 3 years ago, she was 8. She knew her way to school, but refused to go there on her own. I started at first my research with her because I wanted to find out why. Later, it developed into a workshop with groups of children aged 7 to 9. And during my research, first of all, I discovered that in urban space, children meet physical limitations. They also read codes differently. For example, in case of smaller children, it is more important that a green man is walking in an obvious way than that he's actually green. Children's streets have no names, and the maps are not network streets. They recognize places by views, by smells, sounds, touch, and past events. The basic need of safety, translates in a city into aesthetic space, predictable walls, feeling important and noticed. To fulfill the need of play, they dialogue with space, using infrastructure as toys, inventing their own walls, and sometimes to influence city, they even use magic. I started writing articles about my findings, presenting conclusions during conferences, but was all talking to adults. Often I was telling them about problems they didn't notice or understand because they didn't see many independent children in urban space. And it was a vicious circle. Unfriendly urban space, which doesn't fulfill kids' needs of safety and play, discourages children from using urban space on their own. As a result, because there's not many kids outside, children don't feel safe and prefer to be accompanied by adults. And then adults don't see the need to adapt the space to children's needs, so it stays unfriendly. And that's the vicious circle I want to break. And having my previous experience of working for real estate sector, I knew how slow things were in there. And by the time adults would start applying the child-friendly perspective, especially in Poland, many, many kids of today would grow up. So I started thinking of a tool that could be of help here and now, something that could be used on a bigger scale than my workshop with children. And especially that from talking to kids, I knew that carers, parents or teachers didn't always know how to support them in the first independent steps in a city. And that is how I came with the idea of a book that I'm working on now. So that's all. If you like my characters, I encourage you to check the Instagram of my illustrator. It's a wonderful 17-year-old Marianna, and who appeared in my life exactly the day I needed her. But it's a totally different story for another day, so thank you.
Thank you so much, Beata. I'm very happy to see also how the stories connect, right? From the children to the parents' perspective, to the top-down, the private sector, and now also from the researcher perspective, how all these findings get together, and yes, how children's experience the public space in a very different way with their different senses, and how they remember public spaces like these and where they feel important, of course. So it's very nice, and it's very nice to see how the children were part, active part of this research by being researchers themselves, and of course with these very wonderful illustrations. So thank you so much, and we hope we can also start getting the book soon. So keep us posted. Okay. So for our next speaker, I'm going to welcome Matsi Sacher. He's also a proud member of the Placemaking Europe Kids, and he will bring today on the table his perspective as a local government representative and an urban activist. And he will present a case of safe and sustainable school travel in a small and medium-sized cities of the example of Skawina. He's an architect, an urban designer, urban activist, and a city lover. So, yeah, without further ado.
Thank you for this interaction. Hello, everyone. How are you doing? It's a pleasure to be here with you. Let me tell you my story, but first, thanks to Beata for introducing the very reason started to deal with that issue, the issue of the last safe pile, the issue of the last safe kilometer in our European standards, and the safe and sustainable school travel. So first things first, I'm working in a fairly small municipality in the south of Poland within the functional urban area of Krakow. It's urban-rural municipality, so it's kind of a challenge to deal with bringing kids to school by car, which is the predominant way the children are being delivered to school. And there are so many other ways and so many problems caused by that. So we've decided to change this because we want to provide the children with a safe and enjoyable environment on the last kilometer from school. That's what Beata said about how to make children go on their own to school. And by this, to create more livable and lovable city for everyone. The challenge was motivated first and foremost because of the road safety. We don't want children to get hurt on their way to school. We want them to feel safe. At the same time, we have to tackle the congestion. And that's one of my tasks as a mobility urbanist in Skawina. Other very important issue is the children independence and the inclusiveness. Because when we deliver children to school, when we drive children to school, then we detach them from the built environment and we detach them from the social interactions. So they grew up in the city that they don't know of anything. They just are being kind of teleported between points. And that has severe consequences in the public space, in a social tissue of the city itself. So it's well connected to the social responsibility, because when the children don't have an interaction with other human beings, they automatically kind of becoming less responsible for themselves and for the built environment, for the fellow citizens of the city. Of course, it also applies to environmental impact, and we want to create the more livable city by this. So what we did is we've mapped all the primary schools in Skawina, in the town of Skawina, and we draw a circle showing 1 kilometer radius from school. And ta-da, we realized that the whole city is covered. So we came to this conclusion that if we deal with the issue of the pedestrian safety, of the safe and sustainable school travel, we then will change the whole city. You can do it by yourself. Here we use the My Maps Google, so you can do it by yourself as well and check it out. So I've created the program called the Safe Last Kilometer, which in the beginning was called the Last Safe Kilometer, but has a slightly weird connotation, so it's now the Safe Last Kilometer. Consists of many actions. Unfortunately, we couldn't get funding for all of that at once, so we had to chop it into smaller pieces. So it's quite elaborated program, and we are doing it step by step. So it will take a while still, but also it's a kind of a collaboration and synergy between various programs, as you could see on the previous slide. We are trying to put together all the ways of funding for that. So what we do for now is research phase. Research is very important. So this is our model split. We did it in the course of Interreg Central Europe Low Carb project. And we surveyed all the schools in the municipality using STARS methodology. You can find the link over there, and I also will post the link. It's free form that you can just deliver to schools and get the answers. So we checked out the model split in the schools of Skawina, and then if we have a space for the change, the desired school travel mode. So we can see now that there is a space for change, there is a will for change from the children's perspective. So we also measured the travel distances, so there is a special possibility of change as well. And we use the more sophisticated but also free tool, Maps Open Source, OpenRouteService.org, to determine the 5, 10, 15 minutes of walking to all the schools. So again, whole city is covered. And now We just did a more elaborated evaluation of the safety network around the schools using drones and all the other stuff. It was pretty interesting, also with some basic ideas how to change the situation. We have it ready for all the schools. Now I'm showing you only two examples for two schools. So you can do it by yourself as well. It doesn't take much money. It doesn't take much effort to do so. And we started to implement some measures on the ground, like transforming parking spaces into the playgrounds. Pretty awesome thing. But we're facing, of course, many challenges. First challenge is that the project had to be cut into pieces, so it's way harder to have a one big strong impact at once. We have plenty of organizational issues, basically, because we are a pretty small municipality and we are doing it as an extra project. Like everyone who's working, I mean, like three people who are working on that are doing it as an extra thing. The lack of stable and reliable funding, which is an issue. It's not the biggest issue, but it's an issue, because then if we'd be funded by one project, one grant, we could make it more sustainable and more ongoing. We can just give some more people work on that. And the difficulty in collaboration with road authorities, because the roads on which the schools are located are managed by different road authorities, so that's kind of an issue. And of course, the biggest challenge is to change the mobility habits. And yeah, we did some cool paper stuff, which also costs next to nothing. So main takeaways for you guys is, if we can do that, everyone can. I mean, really, we did it as a hobby. We started as a hobby and we carry on and we do some serious stuff right now. Money is not the main issue. We didn't have any funding in the beginning whatsoever. So it was all the ideas we did after hours using free tools that are available online. Data evidence-based management, you have to have data to talk to your bosses, to talk to the higher authorities. The community is an expert. Of course, you have to talk to children if they want to change, and how do they want to change. The lighter, quicker, cheaper, so experiment. Go and experiment. We did quite a lot of that, and it's pretty cool, and we're going to do more. We're going to do place games. We're going to do more and more experiment here. Collaborate, bring on board how many people that you can get and collaborate with them. Everyone has something interesting to say. It's worth trying because we are talking about our future, but also about our present. We can change by this experiment our present. We don't have to wait for the money to come. And of course, I am here to help you. So if you have any questions, please post them in the chat box and I'll be willing to help you. Thank you very much. Hope you enjoyed.
Thank you so much. I can tell that it is a very much replicable project. We actually, with Julia, started this project as well with Wasipichanga in Ecuador recently. And everything that you said, it's true. We follow the same. We found a friend that that owns a school and asked her to be the pilot project. And now the municipality is also on board. And this has started also as a response to COVID, thinking that the spaces around schools are very small for the amount of people that are there. And we want to start this project to help in the transition to going back to schools. So it's definitely amazing to identify and to see that the whole city can change if we go school by school. And I think this is great also if you're not in the municipality and you're outside, it's great to show to the municipality so that they believe in this project and slowly you get more people to cooperate. So thanks a lot, Matsi, for the inspiration, and we really hope it gets replicated everywhere.
You're welcome.
Okay, and our last but not least speaker of today, I want to welcome Urška Kran. Again, I'm saying it wrong, probably. But she's a landscape architect in Slovenia. She's a designer and co-founder of PATSI, Park Association, which is an NGO that mainly focuses on play and involving children in placemaking. In this context, she and her colleagues are developing different workshops and other events aimed at explaining the children aspect of play areas. She will present today a series of workshops which enable children to confidently talk about the projects and playgrounds through the third eye. Welcome, Urszka. The floor is yours.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for this opportunity. I will just try to share the screen. So here it is. Okay. So in the last 5 years of our existence in the association, we developed quite a big number of different workshops working with children in primary schools and in the kindergarten. And the last of the series of these workshops turned out to be really interesting because we included video as a media that would enable us to communicate with children without interfering as adults. So the thing that led us to this conclusion to use the video was actually a series of different methods in which drawing was one of the most common ones. And it turned out that in drawing, children really switched their imagination to the max. And it was really interesting to find such drawings as this one that could really relate to different play equipment that's already on the market. And of course, I'm sure that the child that drew this didn't really see this well for real, nor in some books. This another example, which is actually far from the video process that we entered in the last workshops, shows something similar. This was drawn by a boy in a kindergarten. And it's kind of inspiring to see that the play equipment relates to thoughts of children translated as drawings. Of course, the reality is that these drawings were really rare. These kind of drawings were really rare among children when we were, for example, having arranged a box of wishes in one of the schools. A majority of wishes that were thrown into the box were far from play equipment. But actually most of the children wanted to have tables and chairs outside so they could eat outside, which was quite interesting to see that they don't only think of playing on equipment such as slides or swings, but also think of space in many different ways. For example, in the kindergarten, when we did something similar, we found out that the majority of children aged 2 or even younger were describing their janitor, their caretaker mowing the lawn when we were talking about the playground. So we were really interested to know all these other aspects of thoughts that children have related to playground. And we decided to, actually, when we were thinking of how to make them think about space in all these different ways, we decided to exclude ourselves as adults as much as possible and give them a chance to communicate with themselves without us being there. So the idea was to make a video workshop where the kids will test themselves in role of a cameraman, of an actor, and they would later also edit the film. So it was quite surprising in a way to see that most of the videos were taken in relation to nature. Whether they were hiding in a bush or under a tree or trying out leaves or getting stung by a plant, it was really interesting. So we were also learning to see some differences between boys and girls. While boys were mostly quite often in related, their games were related to physical activities and competitions. The girls were thinking or just talking. What was related to girls was they were more often taking attention to different materials, such as wood or metal in playground. So this was another thing that was really interesting was that children were also talking a lot about safety issues related to challenges that they found were quite lacking in the playground. So they suggested some improvements of existing playground equipment, and also pointing out some dangerous, potentially dangerous facts about the equipment, which was quite interesting to see. In all of the workshops, we gathered these ideas into a small, really small scale and especially small budget plan that consisted of, for example, 5 points that were really simple and low budget, such as planting a tree or just removing a fence somewhere or something similar. And we draw this on a sort of plan to present it to each school. What was really interesting was that we did this in 5 different schools and in 5 totally different circumstances. Some of the playgrounds were big, some of the playgrounds were small, and they had different sizes of play areas and sports areas, and the children's perspective were quite similar in each of the playgrounds. So we decided to take this into guidelines and also equipped these guidelines with some comments from other professional fields, such as kinesiology or psychology. And we put all these perspectives in a book that just came out now. And we see it as a kind of encouragement to include children in designing play spaces more often. This is it. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Urshka. It's really nice. It's really nice to see how children can be designers themselves and provide guidelines for designers to change the public space. So we really appreciate your presentation today. Yes, well, for the next part, I am aware that we have very little time, but yes, we would really love to see the audience a little bit. So we encourage everyone to maybe open the cameras for a little while to see how they're doing. They can show us their smiles. And we would love to take a picture of everyone as well. Of whoever would love to be in the picture, just open their cameras and we'll see everybody that has been here. So we give you a minute to do that. And yeah, to show us your best smiles today. So yeah, in the meantime also speakers can relax a little bit as well, right? Okay. More people who would like to be in the picture. And we are not closing yet. After this, we will have also like a short recap of the webinar and a call of action of how can you stay in touch with this group and whoever is working or interested in working more with children, how can we, of course, work together. Okay, so everybody, I would love to see your smiles or do something playful, and we'll take a picture now. 1, 2, 3. And another one. Great. And it's very nice to see everybody. Also, people in the middle of the night already. I guess there's people who it's in the morning time zone. So we're really grateful and happy that you all participated today. And super happy also to tell you that we would love to keep these webinars running. And soon we would also like open up for new speakers. So if you would also like to present your projects, like you can also be in touch with us. So before we close, I would like every speaker to give us a final thought. As you know, there's not a lot of time now for questions and answers, but we will be answering all the questions in our groups. So you won't be ignored in any case. And yeah, I would like to give each one of our speakers 30 seconds for a final thought or a final message that you would like to give us today. Okay, so then I'm going to start again, or I'm going to start by giving the floor in the order I see you, at least. So I'll start with Beata. Would you give us a 30 second final message that you would like to share?
Okay, well, the first one, I mean, the most difficult position, I have no time to think. I think that the most, well, I want to say what's the most important for me with working with children, that first of all, I learn a lot from them, and it's not only learning about how they see the world, but mainly I learn about inclusion, and I learn about the need. When you talk to somebody, not just come with the ready answers, but just come and really open and listen and just see what the other party wants to give you. And then, you know, you can think that you know something. Thank you.
Thank you, Beata. I'm going to go for Bas now.
Here we go. Hi. Message. Well, I think... my main message would be keep using the cool ideas of kids, but use them in combination with other creative minds. So really try to find the synergy between the thinking of kids and the creativity of adults, and use the best of both worlds. And the main message would be not to solely take the answers of kids as 100% true, but play with them and use them as inspiration to come up with something really, really cool.
Yep. Thank you, Vas. Awesome. Urška.
Okay. Maybe I would say that sometimes we don't really need to ask children everything, but we just need to watch them and hear them and just look at them and see how they're doing without and just take action upon that.
Awesome. Thanks a lot. Matsi?
Yeah, I would say that I'd like to encourage you to be humble, to be curious, to be adventurous, and especially in this day, don't forget that you have this kid somewhere inside, and just be playful, and just don't be such an adult. Just don't. All the best, guys.
Thanks, Matzi. Happy day to you.
Children's Day.
Okay, Adriana.
Yes, thank you. So I will repeat what I've heard from children and young people in various forums. First is that they would want to see more tolerance, more towards diversity in many different circumstances. So I think that's also a message to us on to work on promotion, on awareness raising, and then focusing on participation. We've heard many, many inspiring examples of how children are heard. But yeah, they want to be heard, they want to be considered, and I think it's also our responsibility to understand that there's a need to provide feedback, and it's a two-way interaction. And thank you, this was very inspiring.
Thank you for being a part of this. Last but not least, Royal.
Hi, don't forget, most of the times, one-fifth of your population are youths. They don't have the right to vote. But they do live now. They're not the future. They live now with real-life experience. And those experience we need when we change something, because they have experience in their life now. And just go straight to the core. What do you think is good, is bad, what we need to change? And don't put too much fuss about making a fun activity. Just ask straight, and then they know you're taking them serious.
Awesome. Thank you so much. I'll invite everybody to give a round of applause like this, which is what we can now. But thank you so much to all the speakers and everybody that participated. And well, don't leave yet. I'm going to invite Julia to let us know what are these next calls of action to remain together as a group working with kids.
Yeah, thank you, Vivi. And thank everybody, all the speakers and who was with us today. Call of action, very briefly and short. We would like to keep in touch with everybody and get more sessions like this in the coming year, in the coming period. We were thinking with the core team to have, for example, 4 webinars per year. So we would like to welcome other speakers that would like to share their experience, share their knowledge, their examples about child-friendly cities and how it's actually important to work for more inclusive cities with children. So as Hoiske already shared in the chat, and I'm sharing again now, we would like to invite you to our Facebook group, that's Making Europe Kids. Here is the link. So please join us and join the conversation to share maybe more of your ideas. And also the speakers have the chance to answer certain questions that maybe we didn't have the time to answer during this webinar. Also, through the same email you receive from Eventbrite about the details about the event, we have shared another link of a quick survey if you want to give us some feedback, for example, and also if you would let us to keep your email contact so we can add you to our mailing list and inform you all the upcoming activities and, well, as this webinar and others that we're going to organize together. And yeah, well, in this case, you will become one of the members of Please Making Europe Kids. We hope many of you will join. And thank you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Julia. Yes, we would also like to know what did you think about this webinar. So we prepare a very short word cloud exercise. So you can go to menti.com. This is in the chat, and Goitske will share with us her screen right now to have a quick overview of what all you think about this webinar. And so I guess everybody can see in the chat menti.com, and there's the code in which you can share in one word what do you think about this webinar. Awesome. Inspire, educational, fun. We are definitely also very inspired today. It's a great way to really celebrate World Children's Day. I'm so happy to have you all. Right, and while this is going, I'm going to also give the word, the final word for a sad goodbye, but yes, it was really amazing. We'd love to have you here, and I'm going to pass the word now to the floor to Maya. And yes, once again, it was really fun and very insightful to see and to hear all the stories. I was super happy and honored to be able to moderate this first webinar of hopefully many others to come. So yes, you can see how everybody is. Hopefully this was a wake-up call, and this was an inspiring way that would lead us to more solutions. So yeah, Maya, please. Oh, Maya, I think you're muted.
Sorry for that. Thank you for the word, but I don't know what to add. Everything was said, and it was like really very interesting meeting. Really nice to follow all the inspiring guests. I think the diversity of the approaches and themes is like really something we will be inspired in the future. So the greatest, I would say, thank would go to our speakers today, because they join us openly and not having any problems with, we don't have any kind of money or anything to give them. We just invited them and they were all willing to join, which means that we are taking seriously the question of children being part of placemaking, urban design, and all the stuff being related to cities. And what I think we it's really nice is the exactly the fact that we are trying to be a little bit childish, as much as say, but we are then also very serious, and the all the approaches are showing that we have like many options how to do it and still be I would say in a relation to everyday business. It's not something very special. It's like urban design or spatial planning anyhow. You just think about the special groups, and this only make it much better for everybody. And I would close with this and won't take you any more time because it's Friday afternoon. Have a nice day, and please do join us with ideas so that we could meet again as soon as possible. Bye.
Bye, thank you.
Bye, everyone. Thank you so
much. Bye.